Dear Facebook Urology viewers, today evening topic is uroflowmetry. We all feel uroflowmetry is a small subject, but if you go into the depth, because it is basics, it is better. So last time when Dr. Mayank Agarwal has done the urodynamic study, lot of people requested to do it on first uroflowmetry. On the other way around, I might have done uroflowmetry first and then done urodynamic study. So now at least we are doing uroflowmetry by the same speaker. I'm happy that Mayank is accepting for the same, and he is focused on basics of this uroflowmetry, and he prepared in a short time. And today we will discuss without wasting any time the basics of the uroflowmetry, as well as how to read what are the minuses and pluses of the uroflowmetry. As I have already introduced Mayank, it is more. I will share the screen and directly introduce, so that we will go directly to the topic. So uroflowmetry is the stethoscope of the urologist, and Dr. Mayank Mohan Agarwal is again, for those who have not listened previously, he is from PGI Chandigarh. He is 6 months junior to me, but we were very close together as friends, and then we learnt each other during our almost 2.5 years common period together in PGI. And he was National Gold Medal DNB Urology, awarded fellowships in Uro-Oncology, Pelvic Floor Reconstruction from Urology USA, Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, New York, University of California, Los Angeles, Wake Forest University, Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Faculty member at PGIMER, nearly for 10 years he worked and written nearly 80 articles, chapters in books and handbook of urodynamics from 2005 to 2021. Associate editor in BMC Urology, introduced novel concepts in population, specific flow volume nomograms and flow volume index in uroflowmetry, repopularized micturition urethral pressure profilometry, discovered a novel plateau detrusor pattern in patient with pelvic floor dysfunction, affirmed superiority of the gabapentin over pregabalin in UCPPS and novel PGIMER pouch. He has 16 years of extensive post-MCH clinical experience in endourology, advanced urology laparoscopy, uro-oncology, advanced urodynamics, female urology and neurology, neurourology. He is currently working as associate director of urology Medanta, the Medicity, Lucknow, UP, India. I'm happy that he is doing all the work related to the urodynamic study and of course the transplant, kidney transplantation also in Medanta, apart from the routine laparoscopy and endoscopic urology. Mayank, I will directly hand over to you. Please proceed with your talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chandramohan, for giving me this opportunity once again. So uroflowmetry is so basic to a urologist as a stethoscope to a clinician or a cardiologist. So without understanding uroflowmetry, we do not proceed in understanding the low urinary tract dysfunction. So what is uroflowmetry? Uroflowmetry is basically graphing of urine flow rate over time. So on the y-axis of a graph, you have a flow rate, and on the x-axis, you have that particular time at which the flow rate is happening. Now, what does uroflowmetry denote? Uroflowmetry denotes the final outcome of bladder function and outlet function. So ultimately, whatever the final interaction between these two will happen, it will project in the uroflowmetry. For example, if you have a overactivity, so very strong bladder contractions, but no problem with relaxation of outlet. So you will have one type of flowmetry. You can imagine that it's going to be a really fast flowmetry. On the other hand, if you have a good bladder, but prostatic obstruction or stricture, so you will have a slow continuous flow. Or you may have a weak bladder. In that also, you will have a slow, continuous, or interrupted flow. So uroflowmetry gives you the initial idea of the final outcome between these two interactions. Now, the most important thing it depends on, the flowmetry depends on, giving that everything else is same. So let's say bladder function remains the same, outlet function remains the same in a given individual. So you have a preload which decides the flowmetry. Preload means that what is a preload for urine passage is bladder volume. The way the preload in heart function is blood. So the more the volume, the more the water head for the flowmetry, and the more higher the flow of the uroflowmetry. Then we know that our urinary tract function is so much a personal thing that a lot of social inhibitions make a role to play in having an interpretable uroflowmetry. For example, you need a privacy. There are people in everyone's OPD who say that if I go to a public toilet, I just cannot pass urine. And similarly, imagine a person coming to your OPD and there is so many people around, and then particularly in a government hospital, when you have, you know, really a rush of people, how will the person be able to pass urine? Then familiarity. Same goes for these people who find it difficult to pass urine in a public toilet because there's so much used to in passing in a familiar surroundings. And voiding position. There are people who would void in standing. Most of the people can void in standing as well as sitting position. But there are few, like we get people from villages who just cannot pass urine in standing. They want their squatting position only to pass urine or stools, whatever. So these things play an important role, central role rather, to decide whether your uroflowmetry is going to be a successful test or not. So patients should be counseled for adequate performance, how the patient should be counseled. So it is a very common thing because that your doctor is not doing uroflowmetry, the nurse or technician is doing it. So they will typically say 2 liter pani piyo, take 2 liters of water, and when your bladder is about to burst, come back. No, you should not do that. The patient ideally should have a comfortably full bladder, after which the patient usually goes and passes urine. If you let the bladder fill to the extent of pain, there will be spasm of outlet and the result may not be as good. If you let the bladder over distend beyond, let's say, 500 ml, then the bladder function reduces and the flow may not be representative. The second is we should have provision for the patient to pass urine in an accustomed position. As we already discussed, standing, sitting, or sometimes we may have to make a provision of squatting position also. And it is possible, it's very easy that a sitting chair which doesn't have a side supports, you may just ask the patient to squat and then clean it later properly. But it is important for the person, it's a responsibility of your technician or nurse to ask what is your accustomed position to pass and encourage the patient to pass urine in that position only. Then we should ask the patient not to perform. This is not a performance of a procedure. They should be passing urine as in their usual way. So, and they should be careful not to spill the urine around. If the urine is spilling here and there, then your flow will not be representative. And the graph will be irregular, and obviously there will be dirt, it will be dirty around. First of all, ask the patient not to strain for passing urine. Just to get a good flow, that my doc will get a good flow, let me just push. So, unless it is habitual for the patient. Do not cruise or play around. Important for children and even for adults sometimes, that they have started passing and just moving around their stream all around the funnel. No, it should not be like that. So they should stay close to, they should pick one spot and keep passing on that spot only. Do not squeeze and start. Sometimes people who have voiding problems, they have a habit to squeeze their penis and then again release, squeeze and release, so that to give it give them a pseudo confidence that their momentary flow is very good. So this should be avoided. At the end of the study, one should always ask, was it a usual void or representative void? So if it is not representative, ask for a repeat test. There is no hurry. I mean, because if you go by Western literature, they will ask for uroflow at least 3 times. It may not be possible or required for every case, but you should always ask, is it how you usually pass urine or not? If not, repeat. Now, going from the basics of how to ask for getting a uroflowmetry done to knowing the types of uroflowmeter. The uroflowmeters are of actually several types. Maybe, something is happening.
The screen, you do one thing, stop the sharing and reshare, no problem.
Does it happen like that?
Sometimes it happens, no problem. I am stopping the sharing, don't worry. Yeah, now you, Mayank? Hello? Mayank?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Connectivity is there, no problem.
Yeah. So there are actually two major types of euroflowmeters in the market, but there are actually at least 10 types of euroflowmeters studied. Out of these, four are often seen in the books. So I just go to describe them for the benefit of maybe the youngsters who are going to have their exams. They might be asked. So there are four important types: gravimetric, that is weight transducer; rotating disc; electronic dipstick; and magnetic. These are four are semi, self-explanatory. Gravimetric is nothing but a weight. You have a weighing scale on which the amount of water coming up, it is checking. Then you have a rotating dipstick. So basically what happens, as the weight of water is increasing, the pressure, the force required to keep the disc rotating at a particular rate increases. So that force is transformed into the flow rate. Then electronic dipsticks, obviously you have a dipstick in the water, and as the column increases, the electronic charges, discharges change, and they are read as this thing. And fourthly, magnetic, you have a cylindrical magnetic field through which the urine is passing, and when the urine is passing, it is generating some electricity, and that electricity is converted to flow rates. But we will concentrate on first and second because these are the most commonly available type of euroflowmeters, and out of them, gravimetric is even more commonly available out of the other. Then there is something called as home euroflowmetry. There are so many things in the market. So what people do, at times a person is not able to pass urine in your toilet, but the patient say that I'm okay at home. So there should be a way to be able to pass urine at home, particularly in children. One flow is not good enough. You might have to ask them for, let's say, 10 flows. So how will you do those 10 flows? So there are some devices, very beautifully designed devices available. So there is one called U-flowmeter. You can see on the left, there is a funnel, and then there is a tubing. The tubing, you can see there are three different, this left design, you have three different diameters. And on the bottom, there is a hole. So once a person starts passing urine, this hole will let only a fixed amount of urine go. So if your flow rate is more, that means you can generate more volume per unit time. So the flow, this will keep on filling up, and it is graduated. You have markers available on that this thing. So as the marker, as the flow rate is higher, the higher the column of urine will be higher, and you can just see at what level the maximum flow reached. And the amount of urine which you have passed will be collected in the beaker below. So you will know the maximum flow rate, you will know the voided volume, and if you can time it, you will know the average flow also. So all the three most important information you can get at home. You can keep a diary, and then you can come back to doctor. Another from Maastricht in Pell design, in which the person pass, again you have a small hole down below. Once a person starts passing urine, there are side holes. They're all graduated based on what flow rate will be there. So suppose the person has a flow rate of 9. Suppose this second hole is at 10. So suppose the flow rate is 11. So the urine will go to 11 only when it is able to the flow is more than what is leaking out from the side hole. So by this, you can have a maximum flow rate. Again, same way, you time it, you will know the volume, you'll know the average flow, and you'll know the Qmax. Now, out of this, the most advanced one, which is called as IU flow. This IU flow is basically a computerized device which can be connected by Bluetooth or by other measures to your smartphone. And it's basically very useful for children, not only to know the voiding status, but also for a biofeedback, because a lot of these children will have a dysfunctional voiding. So one can actually keep a diary, and then as you can see here, the flow is happening and it is being recorded in their smartphone, and a diary can be made out of this. Now, home uroflowmetry has limited application, so I'll just stop it there. how to know whether the Euroflowmeter you're going to buy is a good one or not? So ICS technical support has developed some basic guidelines, like the machine should be able to give a Qmax between 0 to 50 ml per second. The machine should be able to measure up to 1000 ml of volume. The maximum time constant, don't ask me what is time constant, I've tried to find out, but the time constant sounds like the sensitivity against time. So suppose within 1 second the flow from 5 became 10 or 7, so it should be able to detect the flow changes within less than 1 second. So, and the accuracy should be up to plus minus 5% or more accurate. So whenever you're going to buy an Indian or international, whatever Euroflowmeter, you should always go to their website and see the product, this thing. So I just browsed through and found that Centron website, they have given their machines recommendations, and it is accurate by 2%. So it's a good one. Based on this accuracy of 5%, the International Continence Society has said that the flow rates should be given as the nearest complete, nearest full value. Let's say if the flow is coming to be 17.2, so you should give it a 17, or if it's coming as 17.8, you should give it at 18, but that's up to you. Euroflowmetry setup should be ideally within a toilet, or you should make something like toilet so that the patient leads is least alienated to the environment. In fact, there are some Euroflowmeters now available. I was going through a Japanese website that the person will pass away in the usual toilet only, and that it's computerized itself, and that will give you a Euroflowmeter reading also. Euroflowmetry with EMG, I'm sorry, I was not able to get the graphs. I tried a lot because all my data was erased. I messaged Chandramohan. So in children, it is very important at times to do Euroflowmetry with the perineal EMG. So if you have an EMG with you, you have two active electrodes, one around each side of anus and another passive electrode medial side of thigh, then ask the person to pass urine. So you will see the EMG changes before starting passing urine and during passing urine. So usually you should have a baseline EMG graph, and once a person starts passing urine, it should narrow down, it should become relaxed, and then at the end of passing urine again it should become baseline. If the person is having increased EMG activity during the Euroflow, that leads to a diagnosis of either abdominal straining or a pelvic floor non-relaxation. Abdominal straining in children is predominantly because of this diagnosis only. Rarely, very rarely, a bladder neck obstruction will be there. So it it means that EMG with Euroflowmetry will be a very important adjunct to the tool. Many times you can actually avoid urodynamics, and you can just make a diagnosis by Euroflowmetry, and you can actually start biofeedback by this. You will tell the child that you'll teach them relaxation and confirm the relaxation by doing EMG, and then see their flows with EMG. Now, coming to the parameters of a Euroflowmeter. As I said, the Euroflowmetry is on the y-axis flow rate, to x-axis the time. So you have this curve. The area under this curve is actually voided volume. So that means flow rate means ml per second into second in time means ml. So that means the whole area under curve is volume. And advanced machines like MMS, etc., they have the software to actually calculate the amount of volume also. So you have voiding time, you have Q max, you have average flow rate, you have time to Q max, etc. So I will come in the next slide what individually is seen. So in an intermittent flow, the important, the common question is, what is the Q average? How do you calculate Q average? Is it the total time from start to end, or is it only the flow time? So you have voiding time from start till the end, which includes the interruptions also. And then you have flow time, which is detected only the float flows. All the negative periods are deducted. So average flow is basically voided volume divided by flow time, not the total volume time. Coming to the patterns, if you have no obstruction and strong detrusor, So you will have either a bell pattern, which is for a stable diffuser, good outlet, relaxing outlet, a bell pattern, or an accentuated bell pattern, which is also called as spiky or a tower pattern, in which you have good relaxation, but the contraction of diffuser is excessively strong. You will see this in diffuser overactivity patients. Sometimes you will see in severely obstructed patients post TURP. Post good TURP, it will take some time for the bladder to reduce the contraction amplitude. So you will see tower pattern. And sometimes in women, when they have stress, very severe stress urinary incontinence, they will have a tower type of pattern. So these three categories, you will find tower type pattern. Then you have patients who have poor detrusor function or bladder outer obstruction, whether it is at bladder neck, whether it is at sphincter, whether it is stricture. So you will have a bell which has been dampened, as if you have just dampened the bell or you have extended the bell. So that is a dampened bell pattern. It is commonly seen in, it's a very common pattern for us to see in our OPDs. It is basically seen in patients of prostatic obstruction. But having said that, it is not a diagnostic of prostatic obstruction. So if you see an old person having this type of pattern, you don't say, oh, you have prostatic obstruction, go for surgery. So this is just saying that either his bladder detrusor is poor or there is an obstruction or both. Same, the only abnormal pattern which is almost pathognomonic, I would say almost, because there is another category of patients who have this, a box pattern or plateau pattern, in which the flow increases to a Qmax and just stays there almost throughout the whole void and then just ends. So this is called box or plateau pattern. What this pattern denotes is that there is a constrictive obstruction, means fixed obstruction. What is that diagnosis? Stricture. Most of the time, if you see this pattern, around 85 to 90%, I was reading a study in which they have actually found it 89% diagnostic of stricture, urethral stricture. Now, what are the other diagnoses in which this pattern can be seen? In my experience, I have seen in external sphincter dysfunction, writing a paper in which we have just tried to find out box pattern in sphincter dysfunction. So we found that box pattern or plateau pattern, out of the diagnosis of functional obstructions, like you take on one side prostate and bladder neck obstruction, on the other side you take plateau pattern or take external sphincter dysfunction. So the box pattern was more commonly seen in external sphincter dysfunction compared to prostatic or bladder neck obstruction. Sometimes in prostatic obstructions also we see plateau pattern. Then you have staccato pattern, means haklata or haklana, jisko bolte hain.
Man,
irregular, goes up and down, then goes up and down and up and down and up and down again and again. So staccato pattern. This is sometimes seen in children with sphincter dysfunction. So that means they are able to pass urine, then again there is some sphincter spasm, then again opening, then again spasm, opening, spasm. So generally staccato by definition is that the changes in flow rate are more than under root of Qmax. Rate changes up and down are more than under root of Qmax, it is called a staccato pattern, and it is commonly described in children or in people who are playing around while passing urine. Then you have intermittent pattern. It is obviously self-explanatory. Then the person was able to pass maybe half the volume in continuous, and then towards the end these are irregular peaks. So this kind of irregular peaks with intermittent pattern is a very typical of a straining pattern, but not pathognomonic. You can still have this kind of pattern because there are patients who will say, no, doc, I did not strain at all. And this kind of pattern is there. So this could be there in prostatic obstruction as well as underactivity. That's why these are just telling you something, but they're not really diagnostic. So let us not over-diagnose with the uroflowmetry. So uroflowmetry was able to diagnose significantly in a box pattern,
in a bell pattern and in a tower pattern. All the other patterns are plus and minus. So in these situations, knowing, you see, usually we talk about flow rate, maximum flow rate, but these are the situation in which we should talk about Q average also. Why? You will see in this, let's say first graph, the Q max is like 20. So if you don't see anything else, oh, Q max was 20. Very good. Very good. You have no problem. Go home. So this Q max is not representative. Actually, this patient's Q average was only 5 or 6 ml per minute, ml per second. So in this patient, so suppose you will see this patient's Q average, which is 5, and the Q max is 20, then you will know, yeah, there is a problem in his flow. Usually the relation between Q average and Q max is around 50%, 40 to 60%, depending on the situations. But if there is so much of discrepancy, you will take the Q average as a predominant marker of whether the patient has voiding dysfunction or not. So in these, both these patterns, you will find this. So people have tried, as I said earlier, in this particular article, they have validated uroflowmetry based predictive model for diagnosis of stricture disease in men. So why I put this up? So obviously we all know that box pattern is diagnostic of stricture predominantly. How do you know? Suppose you don't have a graph, can you think that this patient might be having a box pattern? So how do we know? I told you that Q average and Q max, the relation is about 50%. So suppose the Q average is very close to Q max, that would be because of box pattern. You can do your mental maths in your mind that you have almost a Q max, and then it stays there. So that means the whole flow is on the average only. So you see in this, in the one of the tables I got this, in benign prostatic obstruction, the Q max was 9.3 and Q average was almost half of it. Whereas in stricture disease, there you have a Q max of 7.3 and Q average is 5.1. So it was about 75% of the maximum flow rate. So that rings a bell in your mind that possibly this person's pattern is somewhat box shape. Now box shape, you have to see in the individual case, what does a block shape mean in that particular case. Now post void residue is a very, very important supplementary test, not supplementary, complementary test to end your uroflowmetry. Most commonly done by ultrasound. If you have money, you can buy a specially designed bladder scanner, which will just give you a value by auto calculation. If you have a proper ultrasound machine, you might be having software installed. Or if you don't have anything, just see three dimensions of the bladder, multiply all these three dimensions and multiply by range value ranging from 0.5 to 0.9. Why? Now, which value to select? So if the bladder is almost spherical, you select 0.5. If the bladder is flattened out, then you select 0.9. So most commonly, you will select 0.7 as a multiplying factor. So if you don't have any software, just do an ultrasound, all these three dimensions, multiply by 0.7, you'll get a very reliable PVR. Or catheterization, obviously catheterization is the most accurate method, but it is most invasive. We don't recommend that unless you have any indication of calibrating the patient in that situation. Now coming to the most important part. Now what is a normal flow rate? Going, somebody will say more than 15 in men, or more than 20, or more than 25, more than 12, depending on this thing. So when we talk about a person's demographics, like weight, so do we say that, let's say Chandamohan's weight is 60 kg and Mayank's weight is 80 kg. So which weight is normal? So we don't talk about weight in discussing weight. We talk about BMI. That means weight in relation to height. For a man of 7 feet, 100 kg weight is normal. But for a man of 5.5 feet, obviously 100 is morbidly obese. So let us see this calculation. For a BMI of 22, I took it as a median normal BMI. So for 60 kg, a person would be, let's say, Chandramohan's height. For 80 kg, person would be 6 feet 3. For 100 kg, the person will be 7 feet, typically a US basketballer, NBA player. So whenever we talk about flow rate,
let us talk about flow rate in relation to volume. That means, now I will come to what is the normal flow rate in relation to volume. So this graph I've taken from Paul Abram's book. This is a euroflowmetry of one individual at different volumes. So you will see the flow rate maximum keeps on increasing with the voided volume, 50, then 125, then 270, it keeps on up to 400, it keeps on increasing. But when you see the flow 515, the QO max is decreasing. Why it happens? Typically, the bladder is overstretched beyond 400 ml capacity. Once a muscle is overstretched, with what type, whatever type of muscle, it will reduce the action, because the actin and myosin will separate out too much.
Mayank, I'll interrupt.
Yeah.
I want to know then, in that case, should the patient wait to the maximum level of urgency or normal first?
A usual strong desire. Waiting for urgency is never good.
Okay. Got the point.
Yeah. So a break point is around 400-500. So you should, suppose a person says, no, I pass urine very well, and you have a patient who will pass urine 700 ml and Qmax is 20. So Qmax 20 at 700 ml is not good actually. But it would have happened possibly because of overstretching of the bladder in that circumstance.
So normally, do you consider the volume should we measure at the end of the urophilometry properly and record it?
Yes. See, this is the next slide. So the next slide says, so what we did, we studied this during my PGI days. I had thesis with many student colleagues at that time. So we collected data of almost 700-800 euro flows, men and women, adult, and saw what is the relation, actually, what is the relation between flow and voided volume. So we found out the relation between flow and volume is of a square. So we developed this. It is actually based on von Gerold's formula, which was there in 1956, and it just died out. I don't know why it died out. It was such a beautiful thing. So we actually have revisited it. So bladder volume adjusted flow rate index. So it is VQI is the BMI of Euroflow. And this is what we should talk in terms of. VQI is equal to flow rate divided by bladder under root of bladder volume. Bladder volume means voided volume plus post void. Suppose in a flow you don't have a post void. We have found out that even if you keep voided volume as an under root, that is also all right. Now, what is the normal? How to know that it is normal or not? So these are the normal values written that maybe the reader can see later. But see this. The medium VQI max in women and men is approximately 1.3, 1.2. But see this IQR, interquartile range, that means the minimum, that means at 25th percentile, it is around 1. Around 1.08, 1.03. What does it mean? It means this. So just do a simple mental math. Suppose a person has a flow rate of 200 and
bladder volume of 200 ml.
Yeah, bladder volume of 200 and a flow rate max of 15. So how do we know whether it is acceptable or not? Just do a mental math. What is the under root of 200? Under root of 200 is 14 point something. So our Qmax is 15, which is more than 14 point something. So that means it is a reasonably good flow. Reasonable good flow. It is not normal. The normal is 1.4. The flow should be around 18. But at least we know that it is more than under root of bladder volume. So it is a reasonably good flow.
You are giving a range.
Yes.
You are giving,
so let's say 300 ml.
And BMI has a range that to call it as normal obese, there should be like 32 to 36 is called one range. Like that you are giving range.
In yes, these are examples. So yeah, you might have a person whose flow rate is, whose voided volume is around 225.
So if the voided volume, if you have, the best formula, you are saying that square root of that voided volume, preferably post void residual also should,
yes,
Should be divided. Should be divided the main one.
Don't even divide. Just see the under root dot voided volume or bladder volume.
Yeah, under root karne ke liye you have to go for the this gadget, na?
Oh, come on, man! You are a doctor. A routine under root you can do in mental maths. And even if not, you have this, but you are, it is there at a bedside also while sleeping.
Because I am a doctor, I am asking, re. If I am an engineer, why will I ask?
Oh, come on, man, you have done math till 10th. Maybe till 12th, I don't
know. Anyway, under this, so you have better to calculate the previous slide you show, Mayank, if you don't mind.
No, let me just make it. This is more important. This is more important. Just to what I'm trying to say, how to know on the spot whether your flow rate is reasonably good or not.
Yes.
Just to do under rate of bladder volume and see if your flow rate is more than that, your flow rate is good. If your flow rate is less than that, that means there is something wrong with your flow rate.
Okay.
For the Q average, it is 60%.
So for example, 500 ml Q max is 23. What is this Q max plus?
Q max plus?
29 you have written.
Qmax plus is the median normal, a median normal value. So let's say for 500, if the Qmax is 29,
okay,
so it is a good value. That means for a normal person, this will be the Qmax.
And Q average is acceptable.
Q average is 60% of the under root. So you do single maths, you do the, and let's see one value. Let us see simple 400. 400, what is the under root of 420?
Okay.
So if your Q max is more than 20, your Q average is more than 12, so you're dealing with a reasonably good situation.
So instead of dividing, you are just saying that just square root karo bas.
Yes, bas. So actually, main isliye bol raha hu kyunki main zyada aapko ye
square root. Now, I will also, the reason why I'm interrupting is that if I understand, 99% of people will understand. You said go before this slide. What I understood, I will tell you. Then you say it's correct. You said that voiding the VQI is equal to Q divided by square root this.
Yes.
For that you have separately given formulas. We may not be able to remember those formulas. That's why you are telling that just post-void reserve you make square.
Bladder volume means
bladder volume you do that yes. Value, if it is closer to your expected Qmax, you would be happy.
Yes.
Okay.
So if it is more, I'm happier. If it is less, then I will say yeah there's something wrong, and then we will just follow it up.
Okay, that is a good formula. Is it that formula you detected, or it is supported by the previous 1950?
To be honest, 1956 von Gerold, this is called von Gerold formula. It got buried in the literature. It is not talked about, but it was von Gerold in 1956 who first saw this. But I fetched the original article. I could not get much data. It was a small study or something. So based on that, we run a lot of statistics during that period. So 800 about odd studies.
This you have published, na?
Yeah, it is published. Neuro-Urology, Urodynamics, 2-3 articles are published.
Okay.
So it is, if you go by PGIMER nomogram, one article you will find that. And if you go by VQI, volume corrected and flow rate index, that is, both are studied in Neuro-Urology, Urodynamics.
PGI, they are following this?
I don't know. I'm not talking about it.
Okay. Right.
So going to next. So one way of looking at it is just knowing by that formula, VQI. Or under rooting that.
Yeah, I'm very clearly understood. Okay.
Now, what is the other way? You go by this nomogram. Every Euroflow, you will find this nomogram underneath. Most of the times in Indian Euroflow, they will follow the Sirocki. You will find this graph, upper graph. One is average flow, one is maximum flow graph. In most of the studies. A basic statistic. Now, what I'm saying is that these are based on Caucasian population, white population, Sirocki, Liverpool, both. These are not valid in Indian population. I'll tell you why right from this graph. See this. In this graph, you will agree that median line, which is the, you can see zero line where mean is written. Mean, right?
Yeah.
The line of mean says that this is the mean value of that population on which this nomogram was made. Right?
Yes.
Now see, in the upper graph, you see in the gray area, can you see my
yes marker? I can see
dotted line. You see this dotted line?
Yeah.
This is the mean of Indian population. The mean of Indian population is lying right even two standard deviations.
Mayank, before you say, please explain this Sirokki. What is horizontal, what is vertical bar, if you don't mind.
So, Sirokki nomogram, see any nomogram, what it sees basically the relation between, we have been talking about flow-volume relation.
Yeah.
So, there are two ways of knowing flow-volume relation, a formula or a graph.
Graph is easy.
On this graph, the y-axis is flow rate.
Okay.
And x-axis is voided volume. So, for example.
It again gives a range and a pictorial, the pictorial way.
It is a pictorial way. So, you don't have anything. You just have flow and volume just apply on this graph. That's all.
Okay.
So, what I'm saying, this is a Sirokki nomogram.
Okay.
Our mean values are below the two standard deviation of the Western population. So, if you are evaluating our Euroflows on Sirokki nomogram, we should not do it because it's not good. Second, Liverpool nomogram. See the red line?
Yeah.
The red line is Indian mean. It is at 16th percentile of the Western.
Very low in the graph. Not at all in the center.
Yes. So that means, so what we did, we studied this. When we made this formulae, we made nomograms also for this.
Okay.
For women and men.
Okay.
So this is what we should, this is called PGI-MER nomogram, widely available. You just Google it, internet, it's available. I've been trying a lot because I'm not an enterprising person. So I've not been able to convince anyone to put in their Euroflowmetry or this thing. So just if you're interested, Google it, you will find this.
If you don't do that, 1959 jaisa ho jayega phir.
Abba sab kya karenge? Chandmohan, I will give all this to you. Please name and just please go ahead.
Okay, give it, no problem. See, if it is very good, it should be available to see what we see. Curve. If bell curve, box pattern. If both are not there, okay, you see post-void residual urine. If that is also not giving, we give value to the IPSS score, of course, which has to be given in the beginning.
Yes, of course.
Every urologist will make a mixture of all the three. For example, one person is asking, let me go on lighter, because if you go this depth in between, I have to interrupt. Otherwise, people will leave or people will just keep it in front. See, what I will tell you, see, urodynamic study, uroflowmetry, there are two studies. One costs around 500 to 1000 rupees, another cost around, why I am telling you that one question is put. Another one is 3000 to 5000, something like that. For example, if you are planning a patient with a severe diabetic, old person with not neurological deficit, but you feel that there may be some problem. They are saying uroflowmetry should be part of urodynamic study, or better to do uroflowmetry in the before.
You should see urodynamic study should be done when you are conservative. There is no doubt. Urodynamic study should be, unless it's a traumatic neurogenic high risk neurogenic bladder, you or a neurogenic or other non-neurogenic high risk situation, hydronephrosis, etc. Barring M, so that means all common situations. Urodynamics is only done when it is going to change the management. So suppose your conservative measures have failed. Now you're going to, you want to really know what is going wrong, because I possibly go for surgery or Botox or whatever. So urodynamics is at a later stage. Even most of the diabetics, you can just manage with the uroflowmetry, do appropriate management, manage constipation, because that's an important problem. And then follow up with uroflowmetries. You don't need urodynamics to initiate.
Okay. That I understand. Now, let us come to the basic. No, don't conclude. Go back to the previous slide, Mayank. In Sirokki, Sirokki, you are comparing volume and peak flow.
So there are two graphs you can see. One is with maximum flow, another is with average flow.
What is that brown one indicates? What is that white one indicates?
Brown one means gray area. So basically what they have done, they have marked the two standard deviation below mean.
Okay.
So anything falling in this gray area is abnormal according to them.
Anything falling in this gray area is normal.
It is not abnormal, because it is below the two standard deviation.
Yeah. Above one is normal.
Above one is acceptable.
Acceptable. In the sense, above one, it will tell both. You just mark 500 ml and 12, then put a dot. If that dot falls above the gray line, it says that it is normal.
Not normal. It says it is not dangerously low.
Dangerously low. Okay.
Yeah.
The more it falls to the right top corner, it is normal.
Yes, yes. Right top corner is normal.
Normal. You are saying that these values, when Indian line is taken, already it is falling in the abnormal range.
Already what is falling in the our normal is falling in the gray area.
Our normal itself is falling gray area. How can you interpret?
Yes. So that means.
Who has told us why? See, so let me ask you. Indian ureters are small. Indian urethra may be small, but it is logistically two parameters you are taking: the bladder and urine urethra sphincter. Do you think that all of them are different from European and Western countries?
It is showing here. See, we tried comparing it with BMI, height, weight, everything. There was no relation.
There was no relation.
No relation. So in our study, we took every individual's height and weight, calculated BMI, body surface area, checked with weight, checked with everything. There was no relation.
But so have you compared with Western people in your study?
Pardon?
Have you done anything randomized comparison with Western people?
No. But what I did, I took out the data of those studies: Siroki nomogram study, Liverpool nomogram study. Their average height and weight. So by that comparison, height and weight is not able to explain this difference.
Okay, then why it is different then?
So it means that the elastic structure of bladder, the structure of urethral resistance, they are different. That's all.
It's a surprising fact. If you do
cystoscopy, maybe their urethral calibers are more than ours. So it could be still that their urethral resistance is less, but their bladders are same. Again, the flow will be more.
Mm-hmm. Bladder is also large, depends on the obesity and multiple factors. Anyway, it's all right. Next slide, let us not go into that. Next slide, whichever you say, graph A, C, C, women, men you have written. In your slide, inference you just tell. What does it mean, right top corner? What is this curve, bell shaped, like why?
Basically, it is clearly written, the top two graphs are for women, bottom two graphs are for men.
Okay.
Again, it is on the left side, it is a Q max to volume graph. Then the right one is Q average to volume graph, and same in the men. So for a men, suppose you have a men.
400 ml,
Q max of 10. Let us see where it is falling.
Okay.
It is falling at around 1.5 standard deviation from normal mean.
That is just normal, but
that is actually below normal, because most of the normal people will lie in the one standard deviation.
Sure, Mayank, let us have before you go to the next slide.
Yes.
What I understood is that please do not ignore the volume.
Yes.
If the in the OPD, if the patient passes suddenly just because you order the investigations, if his bladder is not full, it is of less value.
Yes. And if, see, one thing I'll tell you before we proceed. See, these graphs compared to the Siroki and Liverpool are going down in the second half. Can you see this?
Yeah, second half they are going down.
Why? Because we have taken studies up to 800 ml, 900 ml also.
Not the point. You explained this bladder stretch mechanism.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling. Whatever you said as of now, because box pattern and bell pattern, everybody knows. And intermittent, you told that the children. Don't think I'm repeating. That makes an impact on the juniors who might have lost little bit of concentration in between. So you said that uroflowmetry is good, better to be done in a good condition. You said that bladder volume is very important. Box pattern is for the stricture urethra, as well as the bell curve is normal and bell curve is decreased. It is a BPO, but not 100% sure. After that, you told that intermittency can be there in children. The most important point you told that total time of the voiding, be careful in calculation, because he might have stopped, passed. This type of graphs we see a lot. how to calculate, how to remove that when he has not passed. Does the computer does, or we have to do it?
That is a because when the computer gives you Q average, by the deduction itself.
All the basic basic Euroflowmetry like Nidhi, etc. Everybody does that.
Everyone. All of them will give Q average.
Not worry. That means Q average, whatever the computer has given. If it is low, means he has not passed in time sufficient amount of the urine freely. Yeah.
And you will find that in suppose you don't have a graph, but you know Q average and max both.
Yeah.
So if you see that the Q average is very low compared to Q max.
Yeah, I got the point. So I'm coming.
That means there will be two possibilities. One is intermittent flow or a spiky Euro Q max. Matlab the error Q max.
Yes. And at the same time, you told that post-void residual volume correlation, square root if you do, that is very applicable formula, that square root you do it and then calculate how close you are to the peak flow rate.
I'll tell you one more example in this.
Yeah.
It is rare to see a person who has a good Euroflow.
Yeah.
I've recently seen two patients actually, good Euroflow, but PVR is 150 ml.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you will see, oh, Q max is 20. Wow, man, you don't have any problem. But you see a bloody PVR is 150. So if you just don't say wow to yourself, just apply it. So Q max is 20. The voided volume is 400.
Yes, I got a point.
So the corrected Q is all right. One.
Yeah.
But if you add PVR in that, the value becomes down. So that means then this is a red alert.
So what I am understanding is that all the urologists, when they see the PVR after the uroflowmetry, they feel that why PVR is more. You are saying that instead of thinking like that, square root both volume as well as the PVR.
Then you will know that is abnormal value.
That is abnormal value. So for a larger volume pre-void, you should pass.
I'll have to take this call just 1 second. Okay, it's okay.
For larger volume pre-void, he might have passed with very good flow, is the concern you are telling.
Yes.
Don't interpret just because flow is good. If he has 800 ml, the flow pattern should be very good. Unless it is a stretch. If it is 400 ml, it may be less. If it is 200 ml, maybe less. Don't interpret as obstruction. Especially if the PVR is 5 ml.
One second. Hello.
So if the PVR is very less, if he has passed only 200 ml and Q max is little low, so don't think that it is obstructive pattern.
Yes.
Okay. Now this is the last slide you are saying?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, conclude then. After that I will ask questions.
Yes, that's all. So basically interpretation of uroflowmetry is way beyond Q max. Q average should also be considered. Do mental math that we have extensively discussed, and it is not appropriate to evaluate Indian Euroflows on Seroki or Liverpool nomogram.
Okay.
And please use antibiotics judiciously.
Use
antibiotics judiciously.
Okay, I understand. Okay, now I will ask the questions.
Yeah.
Be patient and don't say that I don't know mathematics.
No.
Patiently answer the question because I have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
Number one is, when the patient comes to you to the OPD, there are three possibilities. He might have come fasting, all the urology, ultrasound, sonograph, including radiologist all, they say that you take lot of water fast. Because in a busy center, daily 20-30 scans will happen. You come, you will see the first patient. There will be 10 people outside waiting ultrasound. You write, you take full water. Your assistant outside says that pillow, 2-3 liter pillow. Then he will be crying, I am getting, please. Pre-void cannot be seen. So, will this interfere your uroflowmetry or not?
Of course. Because the patient is not comfortable. The bladder is overstretched. How will that uroflowmetry will be?
What may happen, you tell me.
What may happen?
Yeah.
You may get a low flow, you may have a patient who is not able to pass urine, you may have a false fallaciously high post-void residue, all these things can happen.
Okay. Ideally, after passing urine, again same problem, 10 people will be waiting.
Yes.
I have taken 1.5 liter. Is there any correction? Is there any correction formula, or you should see immediately? You have calculated any formula
for correction? The correction formula is in instructions. Don't take 2 liters of water. Don't ask your patient to take 2 liters of water.
Yeah.
So that is the only correction you can do.
So in that way, the after passing immediately, if you have a bedside ultrasound, is it not better?
Yeah. So what we have, I mean, we are fortunate that Dr. Kapoor has got bladder scanner for us. So we have a bladder scanner at the place of uroflowmetry. So we are able to do it at the same time.
So if you want to
take the patient to ultrasound, just do it in 5 minutes.
Yeah, वो तो नहीं हो पाएगा because the radiologist won't allow. There will be 20 patients. They won't give importance to only you, including my wife, being radiologist. उसका obstetric scan है तो they won't be allowed inside. See, the practical point is, if you have an office ultrasound, if you see only pre-void and post-void, you should not take too much water in a short period, like 2 liters in half an hour, which is next. Second question: if the patient is on anticholinergics, you have given for LUTS predominantly irritative symptoms, he came after 2 months, you have also BPH in your mind, you have also benign prostatic hyperplasia in mind, but 80% of the patient what I see in OPD after 60 years will come with irritative LUTS more than obstructive. This is my observation. In those patients,
why it is so?
No.
Only these people come to OPD.
Yes. Other people will be adjusting.
Yes.
The bothering is the frequency in the night. That is different subject. Leave it.
Yeah.
So, if they come to OPD with alpha blocker plus anticholinergic, you have to interpret as it is, whether the treatment is effective or not.
Yes. See, ultimately, whatever the uroflowmetry parameters, unless there is an emergency situation, means hydronephrosis, UTI, etc., then you will go by the patient's symptoms and bother, isn't it?
Yes.
So uroflowmetry is more of a, at times actually uroflowmetry, you do it, but you don't really bother about it, whatever the value is.
Yeah. So one question from Madhav Tiwari, can this volume based Qmax be applied to patients passing less than 150 ml also?
Yes, that is an important thing actually.
Very good.
That is a very important thing.
Yeah, very important thing.
Often on I do. We have patients who have passed, let's say, 80 ml and the Qmax is around 10.
Yeah.
So I'm happy. Unless the problem of low volume voids is that at times, if you ask the patient to pass urine with a proper 150, 200 ml void, you will not see the same pattern going.
Achha.
So if you have clinical dissociation, suppose
the patient,
symptoms are also not associated, then you should repeat with a good volume.
And one more question. Why not the, apart from privacy part, not showing the face, why not uroflowmetry be added like in Aadhaar card, any video of voiding automatically, so that it may give more information in interpreting?
I don't understand, what's the question?
Voiding video, for example, previously people used to say, if you go and see the voiding in the bathroom, you can say what type of pattern it is. Why it is not included a video of the voiding of the patient? How does it help in the uroflowmetry interpretation? Does it help or no value?
Yes, so it
people say by hearing the sound in your, if you, the toilet is next to your room,
you will not believe there are uroflowmeters. One is optical urometer.
Yeah, that's what I am asking.
Only that there is a flow, there is a video of the flow, and it will analyze the video of that flow and then give you a flow rate. There is an acoustic uroflowmeter, which will hear the sound of that flow and then will give you the idea. So all these things are there. These are all mental uroflowmeters, but adding the video is going to cost.
Yeah.
Where will you add the video? How will you add the video? So that is, but we do, you see, you will do all the time. A patient is there at home. You will just say, okay, you send me the video after a flow, cannot come, or post urethroplasty. So many times we see patients, okay, you show me your flow. So
yeah. I understand.
Very commonly.
That gives a great clue also. That's why I'm asking. Are there any uroflowmeter like that?
There
Yeah, there are acoustic uroflowmeter, optical uroflowmeter, everything is there. But these are not routine. These are all researched. You will find in papers, but you will not find it practically here.
Okay. Next question. Before doing urodynamic study, if you do a proper uroflowmetry before the day or on the same day if you have time, does it have any sense or not much?
It does, because urodynamics will affect many patients.
Yeah.
I have seen very, very commonly women who have come for SUI management or overactive bladder evaluation. Once you put a catheter, they will go into sphincter spasm. And whatever you do, your urodynamic study will not give you a representative this thing. I can show you many urodynamic studies. So if there is gross discrepancy between your urodynamic, see, some flow rate changes in uroflowmetry and urodynamics are accepted. It is known that the uroflow CQ max or uroflow of urodynamics is less than free uroflowmetry. But if you find gross discrepancy, then you have to go by the uroflow. That means there is something wrong with the urodynamics. And in my case, what is wrong is I have induced sphincter spasm.
Yeah, yeah, understand.
Why all these things happen?
So better to have a proper uroflowmetry a day before or in that week, it is better. So interpret.
Day before or recent, I mean,
it's
at the same day, but yeah, you should have a free uroflowmetry unless the patient is in retention. It always helps.
Yeah, one more question. Well, I am surprised to see a slide. Use liberal antibiotics, which I have never seen from your mouth. Not understand.
No, not liberal. What have I written? Use antibiotics judiciously.
What does it mean in the uroflowmetry relevance?
No, not relevant. This is my message towards the end for everyone. In every case, use antibiotic judiciously.
And carefully means.
In all cases, antibiotic prophylaxis, treatment of infection like symptoms, just don't use antibiotic like that. I am telling you, Chandmohan, we see patients here, I've learned about antibiotic which I've never heard before in Medanta.
Yeah, that's why. I know. See, Mayank, your favorite subject is antibiotic misuse. You wanted to train even the general public about that. I am saying uroflowmetry related, it is not related. Slide different karna tha, mereko samajh mein aaya. It's all right. I got the point. Now, in that relevance, I will ask you one question. If any patient has urinary tract infection in the recent, with documented urine culture positive, do you think at 50 to 55 years of age predominantly, where your decision making makes a little bit of a change in his quality of life, taking one tablet of alpha blocker for lifelong is not a small decision. So we don't know whether because of its frequency, because of the UTI recent, not even yesterday, a week back, he has taken loosely an antibiotic. Does it all influence your uroflowmetry? Should actually.
Yes. Because it is very common even for afebrile cystitis, it will cause voiding dysfunction. Even in young men, you will find that they will have this dysuria frequency and their flow will reduce. So it will affect.
It will affect.
Yes, yes.
So you have to...
Don't make any aggressive decision when you have done a uroflowmetry during active UTI.
Activity. So that is also one point. And I have seen, this is relevant to the corona recently, I have seen lot of patients in the last 3 months coming with urinary obstructive voiding symptoms and retention within 1 or 1.5 months of corona. Did you observe? This is totally not related, but uroflow is very, very low.
I observed because of many of these patients will develop UTI.
Okay.
Because they are given, because in India you give steroids also, because steroid is a Sanjeevani booty, even for afebrile or even for mild pneumonia of COVID, you give oral steroid.
Yeah, I got the point.
Oral steroid based on CT findings. So, UTI is very good.
But they are coming with poor flow and classical representative of
possible, because anxiety is so common post COVID. patients have, people have deaths.
My actually direct question to you is, detrusor function affection with the corona, I don't know, but I am observing a lot of patients, honestly, because
it will be worthwhile observing their urine cultures, yeah, and their psych.
Yeah.
Yes.
Acha, one more question. You always mentioned 2-3 times when you came to my hospital and this thing is that squatting sometimes help.
Yes.
Should I tell one thing? Squatting on a table is not a joke after doing yoga and all this. How can
not
you?
Table. No, not table.
On the below.
No. You're talking about squatting uroflometry.
Yes.
No, you have a urofl chair, no?
उसका ऊपर कैसा यू कैन स्क्वाट
बैठ सकते हैं सी व्हाट होल्ड्स यू फ्रॉम स्क्वाटिंग इज द साइड सपोर्ट्स तो इफ यू वांट स्क्वाट इट्स लाइक वी हैव दिस एमएमटी यूरोडायनामिक्स साइड सपोर्ट्स आर वेरी वाइड अ एवरेज बिल्ट पर्सन कैन सिट स्क्वाटिंग ऑन दैट
सो यू फील दैट द स्क्वाटिंग मेक्स अ डिफरेंस
यस समटाइम्स इट डज बिकॉज देयर आर मेन हु ओल्ड मेन पर्टिकुलरली हु हैव कम फ्रॉम विलेज They will not be able to pass urine properly in standing or sitting position. They're used to squatting all their lives, number one. And number two, in urodynamic study at times, I agree with you that if you're doing urodynamics on urodynamic chair, that proper table, which has a foam, it is difficult to sit on it. But on a uroflow, commode chair, you can easily sit. If you can manage the side supports. Why? Because squatting position fixes the pelvis so well that relaxation of pelvic floor muscles is easily done. And many times when our patients are not able to pass urine in standing or sitting position during urodynamic study, squatting helps.
Okay. So now I will ask last question.
Yes, please.
When the patient comes to your OPD, predominantly with the irritative lower urinary tract symptoms, predominantly with the irritative LUTS with high IPSS score, post-void residual uroflometry shows obstructive pattern around less than 10, rough figures I am giving.
Okay.
Post-void, this is a common problem. Post-void residual urine is 100 ml.
Yeah.
So, patient symptom, he says that I never had problem in passing urine freely. Please don't ask that question and irritate me.
Yeah.
If you ask second time, you will say, I will pass easily, freely. You will show like that. You should we, in these three, which one you will take most important parameter to write anticholinergics? My last question.
Write anticholinergics? No, I will not write anticholinergic in this patient. I want to improve the outlet first and see what happens if this post-void reduces.
So you give importance to post-void residual urine if properly calculated.
Yes, because alpha blocker has a minor anticholinergic effect also.
Yes. So this is a message I wanted to put. Yeah.
First medicine is not anticholinergic in this.
This is the answer I wanted. This is the answer I expected. This is the answer I want to tell to the urologist.
And I think this is what everyone does.
So don't add anticholinergics in the first visit when you have a doubtful obstructive pattern because
you should tell them this is a lifestyle problem, quality of life problem. Yes. It is going to stay for long. So give medicine judiciously. What is the hurry?
Yes, right. So thank you, Manish.
Sorry, one last thing. In this situation, I would be very happy if a doctor, whomsoever is seeing, when they are doing a digital rectal examination, teach the patient arginivision. Just Baba, squeeze your muscle around my finger and then relax and do this whenever you have the urge. That along with alpha blocker will suffice.
So you are telling that indirectly you train and help the patients to learn postponing the urination unnecessarily. Don't give brain to alert the bladder unnecessarily.
Yes, to urge inhibition and pelvic exercise. That will go a long way. That is going to be a long way for everyone.
That's going to long way. So as the woman gets adapted from childhood, even men can do that and postpone and then decrease the frequency and improve the quality of life.
Yes.
Too much not depending on the medicine.
Yes, absolutely. Because ultimately, the medicine is there going to stop.
Yes, of course. Thank you very much. Excellent. 100% satisfactory to me at least. Now my bladder is full. I have to go.
Mine too.
Thank you.